وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد وإن شرح في الكتاب أخلاق حملة القرآن written by الإمام أبو بكر محمد بن الحسين الأجري رحمه الله. In our previous lesson we spoke about سورة قاف. And the author رحمه الله he carries on talking about what سورة قاف composes and consists of. He says, ما دلنا على عظيم ما خلق من السماوات والأرض وما بينهما من عجائب حكمته في خلقه ثم ذكر الموتى وعظم شأنه وذكر النار وعظم شأنها وذكر الجنة وما أعد فيها لأوليائه وقال عز من قائل لهم ما يشاءون فيها ولدينا مزيد إلى آخر الآية. The author الإمام الأجري رحمه الله he mentions here what سورة قاف mentions. He says ما دلنا على عظيم ما خلق من السماوات والأرض وما بينهما من عجائب حكمته في خلقه. Surah Qaf, at the beginning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He speaks about the creating of the heavens and the earth and how fascinating they are and that it's a lesson for the believers and it's a lesson for anyone who wants to take it in and believe in it and follow it. That's what Allah says in Surah Qaf, أَفَلَمْ يَنْظُرُوا إِلَى السَّمَاءِ فَوْقَهُمْ كَيْفَ بَنَيْنَاهَا وَزَيَّنَّاهَا وَمَا لَهَا مِنْ فُرُوجٍ وَالْأَرْضَ مَدَدْنَاهَا وَأَلْقَيْنَا فِيهَا رَوَاسِيَ وَأَنْبَتْنَا فِيهَا مِنْ كُلِّ زَوْجٍ بَهِيجٍ تَبَصِّرَةً تَبَصِرَةً وَذِكْرَ لِكُلِّ عَبْدٍ مُنِيبٍ. يعني the creating of the heavens and the earth, Allah تبارك وتعالى, He tells us that this is a what? It's a lesson. There's a lesson in it. And it's a point of contemplation and pondering. ثُمَّ ذَكَرَ الْمَوْتِ. Allah تبارك وتعالى mentions death. وَجَاءَ سَكْرَةُ الْمَوْتِ بِالْحَقِّ ذَلِكَ مَا كُنْتَ مِنْهُ تَحِيدٍ. Death is mentioned. And Allah speaks about it and how the creation are trying to run away from death. وذكر النار وعظم شأنها. الله تبارك وتعالى talks about جهنم. يوم نقول لجهنم هل امتلأت وتقول هل من مزيد. That Allah تبارك وتعالى promises that is going to create for جهنم people to enter it. But then when جهنم is asked, are you full? جهنم will respond and say, oh Allah, do you have more for me? And look how big جهنم is. Allah promised us in the Qur'an that Jahannam will be filled and also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will fill Jannah. Both of them Allah promised. وَلَكِنْ حَقَّ الْقَوْلُ مِنِّي لَأَمْلَأَنَّ جَهَنَّمَ مِنَ الْجِنَّةِ وَالنَّأْسِ أَجْمَعِينَ. Jannah Allah promised in that verse and also in the hellfire Allah tabarak wa ta'ala He promised that He's going to fill both of them. وَلِذَلِكَ the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam He said in a hadith لَا تَزَالُ جَهَنَّمَ تَقُولُ. Jahannam will consistently be saying هل من مزيد؟ هل من مزيد؟ It will keep saying that. حتى يضع رب العزة فيها قدمه. Until Allah places His leg inside Jahannam. فتقول قط قط قط. Jahannam will then say full. Enough, 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 enough. وعزتك I swear by your honor, oh Allah. ويزوى بعضها إلى بعض. And then it takes, swallows itself. Jahannam will say enough, 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 enough. You see, Jannah Allah tabarak wa ta'ala also told us in the ayah وَلَكِنْ حَقَّ الْقَوْلُ مِنِّي لَأَمْنَ أَنَّ جَهْنَّمَ مِنَ الْجِنَّةِ وَالنَّاسِ أَجْمَعِينَ. And also the Prophet told us in the hadith وَلَا يَزَالُ فِي الْجَنَّةِ فَضْلٌ حَتَّى يُنْشِئَ اللَّهُ لَهَا خَلْقًا فَيُسْكِنَهُمْ فَضْلَ الْجَنَّةِ. Paradise will remain spacious enough to accommodate more people until Allah will create some people and let them dwell, it will fill and it will stay in the beauty and the spaces of paradise. Allah will create its people. Ajib, what is that Jahannama, Allah will never create anyone for it and put them in Jahannama just like that. As for Jannah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will create a creation for it and put them in Jannah. That's how merciful He is, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the author, rahimahullah, he said, Allah says, لَهُمْ مَا يَشَاءُونَ فِيهَا وَلَدَيْنَا مَزِيدٌ وَلَدَيْنَا مَزِيدٌ ثُمَّ قَالَ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ And after that, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَذِكْرًا Speaking about the samawat and the ard. أَفَلَمْ يَنْظُرُوا إِلَى السَّمَاءِ أَفَلَمْ يَنْظُرُوا إِلَى السَّمَاءِ فوقهم كيف بنيناها وزيناها وما لها من فروج والأرض مددناها وألقينا فيها رواسي وأنبتنا فيها من كل زوج بهيج تبصرة وذكرى لكل عبد منيب. All of those verses and the ayats talking about death. وجاء سكرة الموت بالحق ذلك ما كنت منه تحيد. ولقد خلقنا الإنسان ونعلم ما توسوس به نفسه ونحن أقرب إليه من حبل الوريد إذ يتلقى المتلقيان عن اليمين وعن الشمال قعيد ما يلفظ من قول إلا لديه رقيب عتيد وجاءت كل نفس معها سائق ومشيد. يعني those verses that Allah speaks سبحانه وتعالى and also جهنم ويوم نقول لجهنم هل امتلأت وتقول هل من مزيد. All of those verses is a lesson for who? For everybody? No. إن في ذلك لذكرى لمن كان له قلب أو ألقى السمع وهو شهيد. سورة قاف will only affect the hearts of the people whose hearts are alive, who are listening, who are smart and are clever and they ponder over it. فأخبر جل ذكره أن المستمع بأذنيه ينبغي له أن يكون مشاهدا بقلبه ما يتلوه وما يسمع لينتفع بتلاوته للقرآن وبالاستماع ممن يتلوه. الإمام الأجري he said, Allah told us in this ayah, إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَذِكْرَى لِمَنْ كَانَ لَهُ قَلْبٌ أَوْ أَلْقَى السَّمْعَ وَهُوَ شَهِيدٌ. Allah told us, أن المستمع بأذنيه, the one who's listening to the Quran with his ears, ينبغي له, what is required from him, is أن يكون مشاهدا بقلبه, is that he really sees it with his heart. He sees what? ما يتلوه, that which he's reciting. وما يسمع, and that which he's hearing. لينتفع, so he can benefit بتلاوته للقرآن, he can benefit from the recitation of the Quran and the listening of the Quran, whoever is reciting on him. ثم إن الله حث خلقه, Allah تبارك وتعالى encourages his creation على أن يتدبر القرآن, to ponder over the Quran. فقال الله تبارك وتعالى, he says, أفلا يتدبرون القرآن أم على قلوب أقفالها. Do they not ponder over the Quran, or are there locks on their hearts? أفلا يتدبرون القرآن. Do they not ponder on the Quran, أم على قلوب أقفالها, or are there locks on their hearts? What does the word التدبر mean? تدبر means النظر إلى ما وراء الألفاظ من المعاني. It is to look beyond these wordings. It is to try to take in the meaning that the Quran has, والعبر, and lessons, and to look at the meaning and the lessons, والمقاصد, and the objectives that are in the Quran, which will then push you towards what? إلى العلوم النافعة والأعمال الزكية. It will push you to righteous action, and it will also push you to beneficial actions. Right? It will push you to beneficial knowledge, sorry, and righteous actions. You look at three things when you're looking at the Quran. You're looking at the meaning, you're looking at the lessons that are in the Quran, you're also looking at the objectives that the Quran is trying to achieve. Then this will push you towards beneficial knowledge and righteous actions. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he said, وَمَنْ أَصْغَى إِلَىٰ كَلَامِ اللَّهِ وَكَلَامِ رَسُولِهِ. Anyone who brings his ear to the speech of Allah and the Messenger, بِعَقْلِهِ, with his aql, يعني his heart, وَتَدَبَّرَهِ, and he ponders over it, بِعَقْلِهِ, with his heart, وَجَدَ فِيهِ مِنَ الْفَهْمِ وَالْحَلَاوِ. The person will find sweetness in understanding the Quran, and they will find sweetness in the book of Allah. والبركة, the person will find blessings. والمنفعة, and the person will find a lot of beneficial things. ما لا يجده, that which he will not find, في شيء من الكلام لا منظومه ولا منظوري. The benefits that you find from the Quran, you won't find in anyone else's speech. And this is only unique to the Quran. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala told us that the people who are not able to ponder on the Quran are people who have locks on their hearts. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقَفَالُهَا. There are locks on those people's hearts. In another ayah, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he said, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ, do they not ponder on the Quran? وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ. If this Quran was to come from anyone other than Allah, لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ They would find in the Qur'an اختلافاً كثيراً, a lot of contradictions. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah said in his kitab مدارج السالكين لَوْ رُفِعَتِ الْأَقْفَالُ عَنِ الْقُلُوبِ لَبَاشَرَتْهَا حَقَائِقُ الْقُرْآنِ وَاسْتَنَارَتْ فِيهَا مَصَابِيحُ الْإِيمَانِ If the locks were removed from the heart will really taste and it will come into contact with the reality of the Qur'an. And the heart will also become enlightened with Iman, if only those locks were removed from it. These locks are not tangible locks. It's not locks where you can go and just break it or hit it or open it with a key. It's locks that are untangible and they're very hard to remove. It's only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who can remove it. The author, he then says, الإمام الأجري قال محمد بن الحسين ألا ترون do you not see رحمكم الله may Allah have mercy upon you إلى مولاكم الكريم your Lord Allah سبحانه وتعالى كيف يحث خلقه على أن يتدبروا كلامه do you not see how Allah تبارك وتعالى is encouraging us to ponder over His speech ومن تدبر كلامه and anyone who ponders over the speech of Allah عرف الرب that person will know Allah تبارك وتعالى وعرف عظيم سلطانه and that person will know how powerful Allah تبارك وتعالى is وقدرته and Allah تبارك وتعالى supreme ability وعرف عظيم تفضله على المؤمنين and you will know by pondering on the Quran how great Allah's virtue is upon the believers وعرف ما عليه من فرض عبادته and the person will know the obligations that are required from him in ibadah فألزم نفسه الواجبة and so the person comes with the obligatory things فحذر مما حذره مولاه الكريم and he stays away from those things that his Lord told him to stay away from ورغب فيما رغبه and he comes with those things that his Lord wanted him to come with ورغب فيما رغبه he comes with those things that his Lord wants him to come with فيه ومن كانت هذه صفته Anyone who is like this, and this is their attributes. عند تلاوته للقرآن Anyone who is like this when he reads the Qur'an. وعند استماعه and when he hears the Qur'an. من غيره كان القرآن له شفاء The Qur'an becomes a cure for you. فاستغنى بلا مال You become rich even if you don't have wealth. وعز بلا عشيرة And you become fulfilled even without a family. You become a person who has honor. Even if you don't have a family. وَأَنِسَ بِمَا يَسْتَوْحِشُ مِنْهُ غَيْرُهُ And you will find company in things that people find loneliness in. وَكَانَ هَمُّ عِنْدَ التِّلَاوَةِ And this person's aspiration when he recites the Qur'an is, إِذَا افْتَتَحَ When he opens the Qur'an, his aspiration is, مَتَى أَتَّعِضُ بِمَا أَتْلُ When am I going to take lessons from these verses I'm reciting? When is it going to impact my life? How can it impact my life? How can I implement it into my life? These are the questions that run in his mind. وَلَمْ يَكُنْ مُرَادُهُ And this person's aspiration isn't when he recites the Qur'an مَتَى أَخْتِمُ السُّورَ When am I going to finish the surah? That's not his aspiration. That's not. وَإِنَّمَا مُرَادُهُ This person's aspiration is مَتَى أَعْقِلُ عَنِ اللَّهِ When am I going to understand my Lord? جَلَّتْ عَظَمَتُهُ Some of the copies don't have that word, جَلَّتْ عَظَمَتُهُ in it. When am I going to understand الْخِطَابَ These things Allah is addressing me with, these commandments that Allah تبارك وتعالى, when am I going to understand them? This is what the questions he asks himself. مَتَى أَزْدَجِرُ When am I going to stay away from those things Allah prohibited me from? مَتَى أَعْتَبِرُ When am I going to take into consideration that which my Lord is telling me? لِأَنَّ تِلَاوَةَ الْقُرْآنِ عِبَادَةِ Because the recitation of the Qur'an is a ibadah. وَالْعِبَادَةُ لَا تَكُونُ بِغَفْلَةٍ And a ibadah cannot be done whilst the person is heedless. وَاللَّهُ الْمُوَفِّقُ لِذَلِكَ And Allah is the one who can give us the ability to this. The author says so many things here, رحمه الله تعالى. He says that Allah تبارك وتعالى, He commanded us to ponder on the Qur'an in these two verses. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا And also in the other ayah, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا Those two verses, Allah is commanding us to ponder on His speech. If we ponder on Allah's speech, What are we going to attain from it? The author, rahimahullah, tells us that we're going to know who Allah is. Now, this Qur'an revolves around three meanings. The Qur'an revolves around three meanings, three concepts. The first thing is, التَّعْرِيفُ بِالرَّبِّ الْمَعْبُودِ, to make the creation know their creator. And the Qur'an, it revolves around one of these three. The first one is to make the creation know the creator. The Qur'an is trying to teach you who the creator is. That's why you keep hearing Allah's names, you keep hearing Allah's characteristics, you even keep hearing Allah's actions, subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of this is what? To know who Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is. And the aim for that is so that your heart now knows who Allah is, so he can honor Allah, glorify Allah, venerate Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in the way he deserves. That you can hope, that you can fear Allah. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْعَلَىٰ. I give an example. Allah has a great example. If Nabiullah Muhammad was sitting in a place, for example, he was sitting in that place, and you didn't know it was the Prophet of Allah, would you give him the respect that he deserves if you didn't know who he was? The Prophet is sitting somewhere, you walk in, you don't even know it's the Prophet of Allah, you're going to shake his hand like everybody else, or you're going to talk to him like you talk to anyone else. But the minute you know that it's the Prophet of Allah, your voice, the way you speak to him, the way you address him, the way you act in front of him, the way everything changes. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَىٰ. Allah is a great example. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you know who he is, your way that you deal with him, the way you talk to him, the way you talk about him, the way you are is going to change. So the Qur'an, that's the first thing that he wants to achieve. So when you ponder on the Qur'an, you get to know who Allah is. The second thing is, التَّعْرِيفُ بِالطَّرِيقِ الْمُوصِلِ إِلَيْهِ. You learn the path to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is in two ways. By doing that which you were commanded to do and stay away from the things that you were told to stay away from. يعني الحلال والحرام. You learn it. The Qur'an teaches you it. It teaches you the things that you need to come with. And it tells you the things that you need to stay away from. That's the way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third thing is, you learn the reward, بَيَانُ مَا أَعَدَّهُ اللَّهُ مِنْ ثَوَابٍ لِمَنْ أَطَاعُهُ وَعِقَابٍ لِمَنْ عَصَاهُ. You learn the rewards Allah has prepared for the righteous people. And you also learn the punishment Allah has prepared for the criminals and the wrongdoers. And that also pushes you towards working hard and makes you stay away from the hellfire and anything that might lead to it. This is the reason why Surah Al-Ikhlas is called Thuluth Al-Quran, one third of the Quran, because it's the first third of the Quran, which is it teaches you who Allah is. Surah Al-Ikhlas by itself, it teaches you who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. And remember, we said the Quran revolves around three meanings, right? The first one is to know Allah. Surah Al-Ikhlas does that. The other two is the Quran as well. So the person knows Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. عَرَفَ الرَّبَّ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ وَعَرَفَ عَظِيمَ سُلْطَانِهِ وَقُدْرَتِهِ وَعَرَفَ عَظِيمَ تَفَضُّلِهِ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. The person starts to know the great virtues Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon the believers. The person starts to know the obligatory things on them. What are the ibadat that I have to do? And by reading the Quran, you learn it. And so then what are you going to do? Because you're a righteous person, you're a noble person, you come with those obligatory things. And you stay away from those things Allah told you to stay away from. And you come with those things Allah urged you to come with. Anyone who does this, brothers, who reads the Quran with that mindset and ponders on the Quran and gets all of that from the Quran, the author, rahimahullah, he said, the Quran becomes a cure for you. كَانَ الْقُرْآنُ لَهُ شِفَاءً. The Quran becomes a what? It becomes a shifa for you, a cure. فَاسْتَغْنَى بِلَا مَالٍ. You become rich when you don't have much wealth. Because the true richness is not how much money you have. It is how content your heart is. And the Quran gives you that contentment. وَعَزَّ بِلَا عَشِيرَةٍ. And you become honorable without a family. That's what Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. ولذلك عمر بن عبد العزيز, he said, ومن خاف الله أخاف الله منه كل شيء. Anyone who fears Allah, Allah makes everything around you fear you. ومن لم يخاف الله, and anyone who doesn't fear Allah سبحانه وتعالى, خاف من كل شيء. This person starts to fear everything. You tend to see a lot of people today, they are always scared of people. Like, ah, oh, I think the people are going to say this to me. The people, they're worried about what the people have to say. You know why? Because you're not scared of Allah. So you're scared about everyone else, but not Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. وَأَنِسَ بِمَا يَسْتَوْحِشُ مِنْهُ غَيْرُهُ. The person starts to find companionship whilst other people feel lonely. And how can you be lonely when you have the Qur'an? That even if you get imprisoned and you've memorized the Qur'an, by just reading the Qur'an, you feel you have a companion. You've got a friend to talk to. وَلِذَلِكَ شَاطِبِ. What did he say? وَخَيْرُ جَلِيسِ لَا يُمَلُّ حَدِيثُهُ وَتَرْدَدُهُ يَزْدَادُ فِيهِ تَجَمُّلًا. And the Qur'an is the best companion to be with, the best friend to sit with. Because whatever the Qur'an tells you, it just doesn't get boring. It just becomes more beneficial and more, it enlightens you even more. The author, rahimahullah, mentions that your aspiration in reading the Qur'an should be that, when am I going to take lessons from it? When am I going to contemplate over it? When am I going to reach the level of understanding this book? Don't read the Qur'an so you can just finish it. وَلِلْأَسَفِ الشَّدِيدِ. To be honest, this is a mistake that we parents do to our children a lot of the times. We'll say, how many surahs did you finish? Very good. And so from a young age, the child learns, finish, next surah. So even when he reads the Qur'an, it's just next surah. How many times did I finish the Qur'an? This much times. Khalas. The person should read the Qur'an lessons. This ayah is talking to me. Yani it moves you. And you ask yourself, where are you in this prohibition right now that I'm coming across? Am I staying away from it? This command that the ayah is commanding me, am I actually doing it? The person asks himself that question. Fudayl ibn Iyad, he said, إِنَّمَا أُنزِلَ الْقُرْآنُ لِيُعْمَلَ بِهِ. The Qur'an was sent down to be implemented. فَاتَّخَذَ النَّاسُ قِرَاءَتَهُ عَمَلًا. A group of people, they've started to make money from the Qur'an. يعني they use the Qur'an as a means of actions. يعني they want the Qur'an to bring them money. They don't see the Qur'an as something to implement in their life. The author then, rahimahullah, he said, وَاللَّهُ الْمُوَفِّقُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who can give tawfiq. We'll stop there, inshaAllah ta'ala. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and shaytan. And Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
Assalamu alaikum. If you're enjoying these videos and you'd like to keep up to date with all of the courses we're going to be running, make sure you head over to amauathome.com.